population is born into this.
Is there any chance for a deal in these talks today between Russia and Ukraine?
The other 87% are born in a country with a weak currency or authoritarian regime. These critics are missing the big picture. Anyone with access to the internet can participate in Bitcoin. It runs on a network that does not discriminate. While Western headlines focus on Coinbase going public and tech bros getting fabulously rich,
more than double the company's valuation, with
there is a revolution happening worldwide. For Gates, Munger, and Buffett, Bitcoin is what poison spread.
The price, it's above 50,000 now. Where do you think it's going?
But for Ire from Nigeria, Mo from Sudan, and Carl from Ethiopia, Bitcoin is much more.
I'm hopeful for Nigeria's future. I've seen Bitcoin's potential firsthand. Bitcoin allowed us to fight SARS, a notorious unit of the Nigerian police with a long record of abuses. In October 2020, I joined the Feminist Coalition, which began accepting donations via Flutterwave, a fintech product. This started off well enough, but then the regime started cracking down. Our bank accounts were shuttered. Bitcoin was the only option left. There was no other way to receive, store, and spend money. This was an eye-opening moment. We ended up setting up a BTC Pay server to process donations from around the world.
But Ira isn't the only one with hope for the future. For Kalkasa in Ethiopia, Bitcoin is about bridging the gap between the upper and lower classes in a corrupt system.
Wages do grow, but not on par with inflation. Salaries in urban areas have perhaps doubled over the past decade, but goods have gone up by 3 to 5 times. The upper classes use the dollar as their unit of account, but the poor outside the city, well, dollars are officially illegal for them.
Kasa's brother was arrested for simply having a $20 bill in his pocket. But the arrest wasn't enough to stop Carl.
I created a Telegram group where I pay freelancers, graphic designers, and translators based in Ethiopia with Bitcoin. In America, most people treat Bitcoin as an investment or as a savings account. But here, I'm using it as a medium of exchange. It's part of my life.
Under the gold standard, Sudan was a stable economy. 3 Sudanese pound once bought you a dollar. There was a successful middle class in Khartoum. But what happened after that, in the 1960s and the 70s, and continue to happen until today, is that the central bank is taking over and devaluing the currency. Today, the inflation is more than 400%. The average citizen is watching their wages stagnate and the cost of living is rising. While Omar al-Bashir and his cronies managed to accumulate massive wealth in form of real estate and bank accounts in foreign banks.
What Mo describes is the Kantian effect, a systemic plague wherein those closest to the source of the inflation profit, while the rest suffer.
Many Sudanese people are starting to use Bitcoin as a tool to escape corruption and as a lifeboat to survive this economic crisis.
Now that is not something I think the world needs.
There is something inherently not credible about creating hundreds of billions in virtual wealth with nothing ever actually being accomplished.
Bill Gates.
Charlie Munger.
Warren Buffett. They don't like the technology behind Bitcoin because it's coming to seize a place in the global stage that they used to have just for themselves. Liberation technologies should be invested in, not shorted. And for those comfortable in the dollar bubble, it's time to check your financial privilege.
Hello, everyone. It's a very humbling experience to be here. At the Oslo Freedom Forum, something I've personally been involved with for 14 years now, and something that we decided to add a little bit more context on for you this year is basically the worldwide quest for financial freedom that people have. In Norway, in the United States, in Europe, I think that we take a lot of things for granted. We take for granted our currency being stable. We take for granted having easy access to credit, having easy access to a banking system that actually works, being able to send money to our family and friends, not having our bank account frozen if the government doesn't like us, not facing things like hyperinflation. Unfortunately, for context, as the video described, that's the daily reality for about 87% of the world's population. They are either dealing with an authoritarian regime where there's no FDIC insurance, and there's certainly no one that's going to protect them in the court of law if the state decides to seize their stuff, or they're dealing with a weak currency that especially right now, is inflating rapidly. And there are a lot of societies around the world right now that are running out of dollars, which are really the real money in the financial system, and the local currencies are collapsing. I'm sure you've seen the news about Sri Lanka and many other places. Today, I'm really honored to be joined by three special guests to help tell you the story of why money is connected to human rights. So we're gonna start by asking them a little bit about what money is like in their country, where they come from, how it differs from where money in our societies, let's say, and then how they've turned to Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies as an alternative. So we'll start with you, Mauricio. You have a pretty moving story about how you got out of repression and economic crisis in Venezuela. Why don't you start talking to us about your country and what happened to the money in your country over the last 15 years?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. And first off, it's an immense privilege to be here. As a Venezuelan, I've seen others around and many others that don't get the chance to come here and share the stories. So I hope to be able to kind of relay some of what we've been through to this group. And you mentioned money collapsing. And to a lot of people, that's this abstract idea that, you know, what does that feel like? What does that look like? Who does that impact? And going back to Venezuela, so just to give people context, in my lifetime, the Venezuelan government has wiped out 14 zeros from the currency.
14 zeros.
14 zeros. That is the number of zeros in a trillion. And so one bolivar today is a trillion bolivares 20 years ago. And that's how much it has inflated.
What has that done to the average person? Like, what is that? Like, that's an incredible mathematical concept, but can you translate that to us in terms of what is that mechanically doing to the society?
So what that does is, as money inflates, right, and basically you need more and more cash to do the exact same transaction, a couple of weird things start happening. So one, Venezuela is very much a cash society. A lot of places, especially in small towns, do not even have the means to accept a debit card. So most transactions have to be carried out in cash. Cash that is not available, because when it hyperinflates, when you were buying this glass of water with a $1 bolívar, now it's costing you 500 bolívares, and you have to find the number of bills needed to buy this thing. And so everybody starts hoarding cash for the smallest things. Your ATM withdrawal limit goes from $100 to $1, and so you find yourself withdrawing five times to buy a can of Coke or to buy whatever. And the people in these remote villages, they don't even have the means to sell. Or they cannot because they cannot take digital payments.
They only have paper money.
Correct.
And the pricing is literally something that changes every day, or even every hour at times at peak hyperinflation. And this is just an immense suffering for the lower and middle classes. I mean, the wealthy during hyperinflation can borrow. They can borrow bolivars from the government and then buy a condo in Miami and then pay back the loan that was worth nothing. I mean, they have those sort of means, as do the 1% everywhere in the world. It's everybody else that sort of gets screwed in this scenario, right? And I mean, you were talking to me about like how people would literally have to accumulate gigantic stacks of paper money just to buy things. Like, we've seen in history books what happened in Germany, obviously, you know, in the 1920s under the Weimar government, but this is something you lived through.
Yeah, but the bills, and I don't know if anyone here saw them, but there was a point where bills became so worthless that people started making arts and craft with it to sell, and like you would sell it as basically as that, as like takeaways, gifts, like a joke, kind of what it once was.
So money died in Venezuela. The local fiat currency died. Today, the country is sort of dollarizing.
So right now, what people do is the country went through this sort of de facto dollarization, and it was something that even though the dollar was outlawed, the Bolivar was so broken that people kept trying to find a way to use the dollar, and the government didn't have really the means to enforce them not using so. And in order to open up the economy a little bit and bring down some of the protests and heat, he allowed dollarization. It stopped being illegal to hold
it's
dollars.
It's sort of an organic phenomenon, like it happened in Cuba in the 90s. And we'll come back and we'll talk to you about how you got out of the situation and what you're doing now with your company. But I want to go to Roya. Roya, why don't you introduce yourself briefly and tell us about what it's like to deal with money as a woman entrepreneur in Afghanistan.
Sure. I mean, thank you very much, first of all, for giving me the opportunity to be here. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Roya Mahbub, and I'm running a nonprofit organization called the Shelton Fund in Afghanistan to empowering the young women through giving them access to technology and education. For those who growing up with the freedom and opportunity, it may be difficult to imagine how the other world look like. And when the education is afforded for everyone who desire it, oppression may seem far away. The technology that surrounded us every day and we take it for granted, we don't know that how lucky we are. But I was grew up in a society that access to education and opportunity was limited and restricted for women. And many of the women in our country, I mean, my country and conservative countries, they do not have, or they have very little freedom to create their lives for themselves. Their lives is actually run by men. Their finances controlled by men. And
they don't have the same financial rights as men.
No, they don't have.
And there might be laws, or there just might be social norms, not just in Afghanistan, but in other countries in the region, with regard to what you are and aren't allowed to do. And that impacts the society in a huge way, because it means women can't contribute to the economy in the same way, right?
Yes. Unfortunately, right now, Afghanistan also, like with the new governments, probably created more rules that, which is already created rules that women's activities in a society to be, disappear. I mean, obviously, when you are living in a country that the restriction on the women's daily lives will be restricted, and women do not have a proper access to proper education, women's systematic operations will never be disappear.
So it's not like you could just, and especially now as the Taliban have taken power again, and girls can't even go to school anymore. The girls haven't been to school since the fall of Kabul last summer. It's not like you can just walk into a bank and open a savings account. Like, if you're earning money through your time and labor as a woman in your country, saving that is extremely difficult. I mean, the best you can probably do is cash, which is very unstable right now because the economy of that country is very unstable because, you know, there's the Taliban are in power, and the U.S. government actually seized the reserves of the entire country. So the economy is flailing, and there's shortages, and cash is not a great option. I want to get into the details of the amazing work you've done to educate women about financial empowerment. But first, we're gonna go over to Abu Bakr. Tell us a little bit about yourself and about the quality of the money in Nigeria and what it's like to deal with the international financial system as a young Nigerian.
Yeah, sure. I'll definitely like to say a huge thank you to everyone that's here. It's a huge honor and privilege to be part of the Oslo Freedom Forum, especially talking about something as really sad and devastating as the financial state in Nigeria. Like you said, the quality of money in Nigeria, I would say the lack of the quality of the money that we have in Nigeria. So I'm Abu Bakr Nur Khalil. I'm a Bitcoiner. I'm a Bitcoin Core contributor. I run a Bitcoin VC. I'm also a board member of the B Trust, and I run a program called Gala along with some other Bitcoiners. We're growing the number of Bitcoin and Lightning developers in Africa. Now, more with regards to the financial situation, it's dark. It is not a situation that I would wish on anyone around the world. So to put it in context, you know, people like to say economics is a political argument. And it's not more, there isn't a place that's more true like Nigeria. So we're not only facing economic challenges, so we're talking about double-digit inflation for like years now, more than 5 years since the current administration
took
over.
Naira was once like the equivalent of the British pound.
Exactly.
Right? Now it's 400, 500.
It's insane.
Think about how crazy that is for a country of 200 million people, by the way.
100%. So back in 2015, it was around $100 per naira, and then it now swiveled up all the way to like, now it's like 630, really.
But again, you know, the CBN likes to pretend like they could just set this rate arbitrarily when there's literally a free market for you to do this, and it's crazy. So another thing is the food crisis. It's insane. So a lot of people, not only are they facing inflation, but driving higher prices on the food. So you have individuals who are earning in naira and facing this inflation, and then now have to keep up with buying groceries. Regular things like, you know, kerosene, because a lot of people use kerosene to actually cook, looking at rice, all that kind of stuff. Everything is now super priced, super heavy. So a lot of people are trying to move out into other currencies, like the dollar, for example. And it's common amongst currencies like the naira, other currencies that are failing when it comes to inflation, moving to be dollarized. So what you tend to happen is them saving in the dollars, which isn't optimal really because of the restrictions on that.
So we can kind of see quite obviously through three countries in different parts of the world that the local currency is extremely poor and people want dollars, but often dollars are very hard to get.
Yeah.
Dollars are very hard to get in all three countries. And in all three countries we've just described, you have to remember, it's not like you can just press a button on your phone and send $100 to somebody in one of these countries with the legacy financial system. There might be sanctions, there might be delays, there might be inspections, there might be red tape. I mean, Western Union, like a lot of these countries, you know, have been restricted in a way that's very unfair. I mean, it's not like the average Venezuelan did anything wrong, right? So you have hundreds of millions of people worldwide that just don't have the same privileges we have. So each of you have turned to the new financial technology to help. So we'll go back to you, Mauricio, and just quickly give people an idea of how you used Bitcoin to get out of Venezuela, start a new company, and then how you're now using Bitcoin to provide financial services to people across Latin America, including in Venezuela.
Yeah, thank you. This is my favorite part because it's about how things got better. So in the midst of the collapse of Venezuela, I had already made the decision to start working in Canada. So I was living in Canada when my youngest brother introduces me to the idea of mining Bitcoin in Venezuela. And the way it worked out, it was in the middle of, at a time where nobody wanted to invest in Venezuela. Everybody was looking to leave the country because it was just a devastating, it was a horrible collapse. But he, you know, my father and my brother and I, we thought it was a good idea. So he starts mining. And later that year, 6 months later, I went down for Christmas. And I went down to a country that was in a deep depression. All of my friends were liquidating their assets, getting ready to leave the country. But my brother was bucking the trend. He had a smile ear to ear. He was giddy. He was basically asking me if my friends had any extra sites or were leaving empty spots so we could get them. So he started mining and doing great. His friends started mining. My whole family starts mining. We start helping a lot of people mine to get the same benefit. And it went really well until the government caught on to how people were benefiting from Bitcoin. And at that point, the government essentially turned on the miners and started basically raiding our facilities, extorting all miners. And slowly but surely, you either became the government became your partner in the mine, or you kind of dropped it down.
So, as you told me in an extremely vivid story that you all will have to hang out with Mauricio later and get the full picture. It's remarkable, but you know, they ended up taking a lot of your mining infrastructure, but they didn't take the Bitcoin. And you guys were able to make it to Canada. You've now started a company called Ledin, where he and his colleagues are able to actually allow people who have some Bitcoin to take out a loan on that Bitcoin as financial collateral in a way that is equal and fair for anyone from any country. So you were telling me you don't charge different rates or have different policies, whether you're in Mexico or the United States. This is a kind of unprecedented idea, and it's all made possible by this open, neutral, new kind of currency. So I think what you're doing is tremendous and really inspiring. Roya, also, you ended up turning to Bitcoin in 2013. You ended up paying, you know, a lot of the people in your company, which was one of the first technology companies in Afghanistan led by women, with Bitcoin. You saw all the crazy ups and downs going from $100. That's when she first bought Bitcoin. It was at $100, by the way. $100 to $1,000, back down to $200, and now where it is today. But you know, a lot of the people that you worked with, this was a massive benefit from them. And you continue to educate girls today secretly by video, and you continue to teach them about financial literacy in Bitcoin. So tell us about like what this technology means to you and to the people that you're working with.
Of course, I mean, in 2013, when we got involved with the Bitcoin, we built a platform that allowed women to write blogs and sharing their creative contents by earning money. And it was very difficult at the beginning to pay because the number of the users growing, and many of these women didn't have bank account, they didn't have an ID to, and they didn't have the family's permissions to open a bank account. And you know, using finding PayPal was difficult. It was sanitation, so we couldn't use the PayPal, we couldn't use mobile money, and that's why we heard about Bitcoin. And from the moment that we heard it, we got excited about this digital coin that give you the financial freedom. And I think that Bitcoin for us is that it's a tool that is allow us to bypass the physical and social barriers. And we are owner of our own money, and is not going to be stopped or censored by government. And also it's not going to be affected by inflation when price of the monies of your country when the conflict is happening. And overnight, your government base changed. So,
and it can't discriminate based on your gender.
Yes, it's
it
not
doesn't even know. I think this is one of the powerful things about this technology is it's open and neutral to anybody and is permissionless. You don't need ID to use it, and no one can stop you from using it, and no one can remotely confiscate it if you use it properly. And you know, bravo to you for teaching so many women and girls about how to have financial freedom. Abu Bakr, I mean, we talk a lot about building financial bridges instead of walls. I mean, a lot of people, again, don't realize that financial system for most people in the world is, again, not so easy. Everything is a gate, a wall, a barrier, a discrimination. So you're living that reality. You're cut off from the dollar system. You're living in much higher inflation than we enjoy, let's say, here in Norway. And you don't even get to make the rules about the money. The rules about the money are made up by an unelected group of people in you know, the Federal Reserve Board, essentially, set the price of money for the whole world, right? So you're looking at this, and you're like, wait a second, we can build a new future for our country. So you have been tapped to lead the board of the B Trust, which you mentioned, which is an initiative by Jay-Z and Jack Dorsey to invest tens of millions of dollars into Bitcoin infrastructure in Nigeria and Africa and beyond. So talk to us a little bit about what your vision is. Like, how where are we going in the future with this?
Yeah, so I think just to tie into the general conversation we're having, it's all about building the bridges that we're talking about. And the thing is with Bitcoin, it already has a lot of these things solved really on day one. So you have an opt-in financial freedom tool, which is incredible for individuals that are under, you know, intense governments who have, like, whether it's authoritarians or it's just in terms of currency controls that are harsh. So to give you an example in Nigeria, if you're trying to even dollarize and get a domiciliary account, what ends up happening is even via the app, you can actually send any money out, and as well as having limits on cards and stuff like that. So what happens is individuals now started flocking to Bitcoin because they realized that Bitcoin is the only way that they don't get discriminated on. They don't get any sort of restrictions that are necessary. So I think the future is definitely going to be Bitcoinized, really, as opposed to dollarized, where individuals are not only saving in Bitcoin, but they're also using Bitcoin for remittance as well as local trade. So that's definitely going to be...
And the vision that I think we all share is maybe a world where everybody shares the same money that's open and neutral, and that one country doesn't get special benefits over another due to its economic power or its military power, etc. And that we have a system that can be, you know, non-discriminatory, which
exactly.
We all, I think, would be a big upgrade. So next time someone tells you that Bitcoin's useless or doesn't have any value, you've now heard three very compelling stories from three very different parts of the world about why it provides tremendous value. And then maybe we have a conversation about its other costs and the mining and all these things which we're going to talk about in the next few days. But those can be made in an adult conversation once you understand that this thing is valuable. So it's been a real privilege for me to allow them to share their stories with you. We look forward to hanging out with you later. And now we're going to have another session of people who are going to talk about how we can scale this thing to 1 billion people. I mean, you each have individually benefited from this thing, but Bitcoin is a technology that's growing, and it isn't quite where it needs to be, and it could reach 1 billion people, maybe. So we're going to hear from four very distinguished guests about that. Thank you all so much for joining. We look forward to seeing you soon.
Thank you.
So we just heard that great panel about the various use cases of Bitcoin for all its humanitarian purposes. And in this panel, we're going to talk about some of the practical challenges and the practical opportunities that we have in terms of how to scale this and have it actually be able to reach a billion people. And what I'm excited about this panel is that all three of these people are builders. They're actively building things on Bitcoin and doing things to make it scale to more people. And so Elizabeth, she's the co-founder and CEO of Lightning Labs, which is a leading provider of software infrastructure for Bitcoin scaling. Hong Fang is the CEO of OKCoin, one of the earliest exchanges to integrate Lightning into their offerings. And Dario is the co-founder and CEO of Moon. So they provide wallet solutions for Bitcoin and Lightning so that people can use it with better and easier user interfaces. And so I'm going to start with Elizabeth and ask, how are we scaling Bitcoin to a billion people?
Thank you, Lynn. And first of all, it's such an honor to be speaking here today. Human rights is an issue that's absolutely near and dear to my heart and has inspired so much of my work and what I do. So thank you, everyone, to the incredible work you've done in this space. So when you hear the word Bitcoin, not everybody initially thinks of human rights and access to global financial freedom, but actually that is what this technology enables. And with Bitcoin, you have a global decentralized network that nobody can censor, that nobody actually controls. And that's what makes Bitcoin so incredibly powerful, is that nobody controls it, right? So we heard stories about, you know, in the last panel, people where the government's cracked down, where somebody controlled it, well, where ultimately somebody took away somebody's money. And at the end of the day, how do people make a living? How do people raise funds? How do people stand up against authoritarianism? Well, they need access to financial freedom. So Bitcoin in its decentralized nature enables people to transact globally. But because it's decentralized, it means that it can't at its base layer have billions of people sending and receiving because of the way Bitcoin works. Everyone on the network needs to know that's running, say, a node about all the transactions that have ever occurred. One analogy I like to use is imagine if in order to send an email, you had to download every email that anybody had ever sent. That's how Bitcoin works at its base layer for people that are running nodes that are kind of like servers. So the solution that we as a community have been working on is called Lightning Network. We're going to talk about it today. A layer two on top of Bitcoin that enables instant high volume transactions with low fees, and importantly, it's global, it's decentralized, and nobody controls it as well. So the idea is that Bitcoin, much like the internet actually, is built in layers, and we can have this layer two on top of Bitcoin where anybody can transact globally, and it can enable this kind of financial freedom around the world.
That's a great introduction for how this works. And you know, from there, we want to get to how do we actually, you know, who are the people that are kind of bringing this to people? And so, exchanges have had their own speed in terms of how quickly they've integrated Lightning, and OKCoin was super early in terms of adopting Lightning. And so I want to ask you, what did you see in Lightning that made you want to get on this early, and what are you seeing as you've implemented this over time?
Yeah. Also, like Elizabeth, I feel very honored to be here. We integrated Lightning more than a year ago, March 2021, I believe. I think the whole thing, we need to go back to why we are building our platform, which is called OKCoin, a global crypto exchange to serve customers getting onto, you know, into Bitcoin, buy Bitcoin, sell Bitcoin, and some of the other assets, why we are building that. We actually have a lot of people on our team coming from very different backgrounds. And somehow we all share this passion of building an alternative system that is more transparent, that is more inclusive, that is not being controlled or biased toward one party or the other. And me personally, for example, I grew up in China, and I personally grew through the period when the country opened up to the external world and adopted a more market, free market oriented approach. I ended up coming to US, going to US, and lived in the US for the last more than 16 years now, because I see more dynamics, more interesting innovations coming out of a free market environment. I actually worked in financial institutions with Goldman for almost 10 years. But what I've learned when I was at Goldman, particularly during the financial crisis, is that there is actually an element of imbalance, an element of unfairness in the system, in the current system. When we are talking about free markets, there was something that was not totally free. And I didn't realize that until actually in 2016 when I came across Bitcoin, when I realized, okay, this is something that actually represents a free monetary system that has never been done before in the way that it was designed, where the money is not created by any government, is not backed by any government or any central organization, but somehow can help people form consensus, thereby enable value transmission on a large scale between individuals. That in itself was unprecedented and can actually help us fix things. So that's how me personally got into Bitcoin and got into the space. We also have a lot of people on our team who, for example, came from Latin America, who, like some of the other panelists talk about, went through hyperinflation and where their personal value and their family was under huge pressure in preserving the value that they're creating. We also have people migrated from former Soviet Union to United States, where when they were a kid, they had to move with their family members, with their parents, left everything behind in their native country, have nothing to start with. They have to start with scratch because all their wealth were left behind. They cannot bring anything with them. And with Bitcoin, if they had Bitcoin back then, it would be a totally different story. So there are so many people on our team with different diverse background, but coming to the same realization that if we want to build something different, if we want to give people, individuals, more empowerment, more control over what we want, how we are creating value, how we are preserving our value and wealth, how we are passing our wealth to the next generation or to whoever you want, we need a different system. And in building that system, you know, the free markets is, again, the foundation that we have to do. That's why we are here to build a platform. But when we look at, for example, exchanges and the crypto markets, the earlier stages, crypto assets are very much speculative, highly volatile, and attract a lot of traders to the space, which in itself is fair. But one thing that we want to absolutely avoid is to be distracted into the wrong direction. As we started building on this, we want to make sure that we focus on the foundation. And Bitcoin, to us, is the foundation and anchor of the new system we're building. And that's why we want to be able to support building the use cases for Bitcoin. And the important use case, apart from the store of value, which made it a great asset for individuals and institutions, is the payment utility that we see in Lightning Network that made it actually possible. That's a long answer to your question, but that was really how we decided that we want to actually integrate Lightning to our product, even if it was probably the customer base asking for that. There's an increasingly stronger voice in our community asking for Lightning for various reasons. I can talk about that, but you know, it's still a smaller portion compared to the larger population that are coming into the space and buy and trade the assets. But still, we feel like it's important to be able to help that network effect kick off earlier on so that we can keep the integrity of Bitcoin as what it's designed to be.
And what kind of activity are you seeing on the nodes that you're running? And how's that, you said it's been a year so far, so how's that been going up to this date?
Yeah, we've been seeing decent growth in Lightning transactions that come through our nodes. We actually collaborated with Elizabeth's team to enable that. There are different use cases for that, but I would say, you know, for customers who come to us and use Lightning, there are two main reasons for using Lightning Network. One is transaction fee, low transaction fee. 95% came to us and because they think that the transaction fee through Lightning is fractional of what you would generally do on-chain through Bitcoin. The second is the speed of transaction. So for example, if you if you send a Bitcoin or receive a Bitcoin on the layer one protocol level, generally it takes about 10 minutes right now, six blocks, 10 minutes to confirm a transaction. But through Lightning, which is a second layer, it's almost real time. So about 90% also came to us through Lightning because of either lower cost or immediate immediacy of the transaction. We've also heard from our customer base, some of them are even using Lightning to do monthly or weekly allowances for their family, for their kids, because it can be in small amounts and it's real time and it gives them a sense of empowerment in, at a very early stage. So we found that to be very very endearing to us and make us feel good.
There's a community member named Bitcoin Rabbi who also wrote a children's book on Bitcoin and he pays his kids their allowance with Lightning. So check that out.
Yeah.
And so years ago when I kind of covered Bitcoin early, I thought about buying some and then I ended up not buying it because the user interface was challenging back then. There was like a friction point and I was like, I'll come back to that later. And then of course years went by, I didn't buy it. And so one of the challenges of bringing this to so many people is that you have to make the user interface better. And so Dario, for example, focuses on building wallets that individuals like me and you can use in order to access this technology. And so maybe you can tell us a little bit about kind of the challenges you see in the industry and what you think some of the solutions are and for example, what's happening with Moon.
Sure. So I think what we are seeing right now in wallets, it's just a prototype of what Lightning and Bitcoin should become eventually. There's still some challenges there, but we've had really great improvements in the last years. It's much more difficult to lose your Bitcoins if you're using a non-custodial wallet, which was traditionally a really big problem when using Bitcoin. Now we have integrated Lightning Network, which, as Hong said, it allows much faster payments and much cheaper payments. But there's still a lot of technical details that will leak to the user that we should get rid of eventually if we want to have a billion users, if we want to have mainstream users that don't really care about the technical details, but they only care about solving a real problem that they have. There's still some work to be done there. We should work on education. We should work on scaling Bitcoin. Bitcoin still relies on the fact that not too many people are using it, so it works pretty well. But as we onboard more and more people, fees are going to get higher. So we need to focus on that. Lightning Labs has been working for quite a while on that problem. But I guess that making it easier for users, educating users, and making sure they don't lose their money are the main challenges for the next couple of years. So in Moon right now, we are working on those problems. I think what we have right now is a really good initial version of tackling these problems. But there's still a lot of work to be done. I think making the Bitcoin experience really simple is important to onboarding mainstream users, to helping, say, human rights activists that need to solve a problem today to actually be able to access this technology and solve the problems. But there's still a lot of work there.
And you're from Argentina.
Yeah.
And so we were talking a little bit backstage about how you came to Bitcoin, because you know Argentina has a well-known inflation problem, pretty persistent. And so that the use case is pretty obvious there. It has rather high adoption in the country. So maybe you could tell us a little bit about that story.
Yeah, sure. So back in 2001 in Argentina, there was a really big event called the Corralito. The government was in really big trouble economically. And so they decided to freeze everyone's accounts. And you could only withdraw at first $300 per week. And eventually, you couldn't withdraw anything from the bank, which was a really big thing in Argentina. It impacted almost everyone. Most people's entire life savings were frozen. So I think that Argentinians, in a way, have a really intuitive understanding about why self-custodianship is important. About why no one should be able, not a company and not a bank, not the government, should be able to freeze people's money. So I guess that's one of the reasons that a really interesting early community formed in Argentina around Bitcoin and saw that as a way to solve their problems. And in 2014, I was working remotely for a company in the US. And they were paying me in the US, in US dollars, but I need to bring those dollars into Argentina. At the time, we had really strong currency controls. You couldn't bring in or out any money. I knew Bitcoin, so I used Bitcoin to bring that money inside Argentina, and it was kind of that magical moment, because until at that point, it was mostly theoretical. I hadn't used it to solve something real. So it was super interesting to see it in action, but it was really hard to do so. So at that time, I started thinking about how we can make it so that these can be used by my parents, but everyone I know in Argentina. That's how I got started into thinking about usability for Bitcoin and making it eventually reach a mainstream audience.
And I guess, kind of touching on the next point here is, when it comes to using Bitcoin, it has a lot of advantages. I mean, as we've heard from the prior panel, basically having cryptographic money is super useful. It's decentralized, nobody can take it from you, no one can blacklist your accounts. But people do have to put up with volatility and other challenges. And so we're also seeing, in addition to Bitcoin adoption in multiple countries, we're also seeing stablecoin adoption. And stablecoins might not be as decentralized as Bitcoin, and they're not as inflation resistant, but they solve their own problems. And so, for example, in a number of countries, people can if their local currency is having problems, they can have dollar deposits in their banks, but then a lot of times those get confiscated. Those get turned into the local currency. And so all that inflation protection gets wiped away from them. And so we've seen kind of increasing use case of stable coins where, there's an external entity that, basically collateralizes those coins. While it's not decentralized, it at least separates the local government from the ability to kind of take those coins away from people. And for a while now, most of the stable coins have been on other blockchains, many of which are less decentralized than Bitcoin, or they're slow or expensive. And one thing that was, I think, very neat and announced recently is that Lightning Labs is working on a protocol to bring stable coins and potentially other types of assets onto Bitcoin. Because what we see with Bitcoin is that in addition to being an asset, it's also a network. You can transfer value, you can transfer, you can convert dollars into Bitcoin, send it over the Lightning Network, and then convert into any other local currency. And over time, that can get more and more native on the Bitcoin network. So maybe you can tell us a little bit about what's going on with stablecoins and Lightning and Bitcoin.
Definitely. So as you mentioned, you have this concept of Bitcoin, the asset, and Bitcoin was actually first proposed on Halloween, October 31st, 2008. So it's really relatively new, and then it wasn't until January 3rd, 2009, that the network of Bitcoin launched and really Bitcoin the asset. And for the first couple of years, what we saw was really people bought Bitcoin and they held it, and you know they used it maybe as a store of value. But as of the last couple of years, and especially with the development of Layer 2 and Lightning Network that we're all working on here, we've really seen the emergence of Bitcoin as a monetary network. And the idea is that people can transact globally, instantly, you know, at high volume, volumes higher than something like a Visa or MasterCard, with low fees. And one important point here, by the way, is the delta, the difference between all the people in the world, especially in emerging markets, especially in authoritarian regimes, that have access to a mobile phone, and those that have access to the traditional financial system, right? And that is huge. If you look at a country like El Salvador, that recently, last year, adopted Bitcoin as legal tender, you have about 20 to 30% of the population with access to a traditional bank account, but a much higher percentage of the population with a mobile phone. So really, the idea here, and we'll get to stablecoins in a second, is that you can tap into this global monetary network, this internet of money, merely with a mobile phone, and that's incredibly powerful. So you're able to do that with Bitcoin, and you can send and receive Bitcoin. We've already seen this in Latin America, in Sub-Saharan Africa, Southeast Asia, many emerging markets globally. But now you actually add in the capability of having access to both Bitcoin and then, say, US dollar. We heard in the last panel about the idea that dollars can be hard to access globally. Well, what if anybody, much like they can get access to the internet, you know, access to information, could access, say, fiat currencies and dollars using the Bitcoin network? That's what we're working on as a community now. So my company, Lightning Labs, recently proposed a technology, a protocol called Taro. Some people might know of Taro root, really good chips. It's used in Latin America. Nigeria is the number one exporter of Taro. My co-founder, Lalu, Nigerian American, and then also in Southeast Asia, so great food for those that like it. So Taro is a new protocol we propose to enable people to issue assets on top of both Bitcoin and Lightning. And what that means is anybody can then issue, say, a dollar. You've got a dollar, you know, in a bank account. You might be one of these institutions in the US. People might issue euros, peso, kroner, et cetera. And then people can transact and send and receive like they would with Bitcoin. Now, as Lynn mentioned, there are going to be different trade-offs. This is going to be a more regulated approach, but it also provides far greater access. And what this means is anybody globally that wants to transact using Bitcoin can now send fiat currency over Bitcoin using both Bitcoin, the monetary network, and then also the way that it works on the Lightning Network is you're actually transacting from dollar to Bitcoin back to dollar. So now you're actually using Bitcoin as this monetary glue, really a central clearing point for all the world's currencies to transact through it. And what this means is the fees can be far, far lower than someone like a Visa that charges now 3% plus 30 to 60 cents per transaction. Well, what if I only want to send a dollar? The fees are going to be far too great. People are priced out. But globally now, anybody with access to a mobile phone can access something like the US dollar using Bitcoin as its rails, which is incredibly powerful for financial access.
One thing I would just add, because you mentioned Visa and MasterCard, I'm not sure how many people in the audience are actually paying attention to the capital markets, but Visa and MasterCard are the two biggest payment companies in the world. But the combination of their market cap is actually less than the size, probably not today, given the drop of the price. I would say 2 months ago, maybe, less than Bitcoin's market cap. So I think that in itself is actually very powerful argument in the value of Bitcoin as the programmable global money network that in itself actually takes on life and evolve and take on adoption in different parts of the world without a centralized organization, without a centralized CEO driving to build it.
And by the way, not to mention cross-border payments, that's such a big financial flow, especially with regard to emerging markets, where fees can be upwards of 10% or more if you're sending something like $100 with something like a Western Union, a MoneyGram. But now, using Bitcoin as this global internet of money, people can send and receive, say, Bitcoin or fiat currencies instantly, you know, at a very high volume for fees that are far, far lower than legacy players. So this really opens up access and opportunities for people globally.
I have one super excited about it. And one thing people can do is just download a wallet and try it out. Basically, there's so many free access points that people can kind of check out and just kind of get familiar with how the technology works. It's one of those things that sounds complicated at first, but it's like if you actually dig into how the current financial system works, it's extraordinarily complex. I mean, any transaction that seems simple on the surface, there's actually this Rube Goldberg machine underneath of, like, you know, permission companies handshaking each other, you know, sending basically debt-based transfers around, whereas what Bitcoin and the Lightning Network do is transfer real-time bearer assets. And so we're running out of time here, but thanks so much for having us, and enjoy the next panel.
Thank you.